This is Abnormal Entertainment.
Feel I'm getting old before my time. As my soul heals the shame, I will grow through this pain. Lord, I'm doing all I can to be a better man. Go easy on my conscience, 'cause it's not my fault. I know I've been told to take the blame.
Hey everybody, this is Daniel Gardner. Welcome to another fun episode. You know, lately I've been really excited that folks are interested more in the show. I guess after a year, you have realized that I'm not going anywhere. So you either listen to me or somewhere I'm going to come to you, because we can come to you through iTunes, we can come to you to Stitcher, you can get us online. So you can go over to abnormalentertainment.com and make sure that you check out all the shows on our roster. We have a bunch of great shows that started off in 2013. So go check them out. Check out the dates. There's a new show up every day. Somebody has a new show up in the air. And on Wednesdays, you can catch my show. Actually, by the time this show airs, actually, I'm not even sure when this one's airing. I think I'm going to do this one. I think this will be the first of the new year. We're starting a new show here at Abnormal Entertainment. I want to thank my producers, Camm Harston and Kevin Moyers, for allowing me to do even more craziness on the Abnormal Entertainment Network. The new show, Vitas Positivam, which is Positive Lives in Latin. What we're doing on this new show is we're taking HIV and AIDS and taking it all the way back to the basics. We're going to take you back to, we're going to deconstruct it and give you the facts. There's a lot of things about HIV and AIDS that is not, doesn't make sense anymore. It was true in 1990, it was true in 2000 when I was diagnosed, but it doesn't stand today. So I think a lot of folks out there, whether you're infected or affected, you're still living under these myths. And I put myself there too. I still live under some of the myths, and a lot of it is just isn't true anymore. So I want to make sure that you guys are up to date information. So if you're listening to the show and you're infected or affected, if you are the son, the mother, the daughter, the uncle, the best friend, the lover, or somebody who's positive, and you have an uplifting story you want to tell, or you just want to put out some information out there, things that have happened to you, this is the show where you want to go and talk about it. We're not scared to talk about medications. We're not scared about talking about new ways of treating stuff. We want to talk about the holistic. We want to talk about Western medication, Eastern medication. So pay attention to that. This show will be airing every Sunday. The new show's every Sunday. Also, go to their Facebook pages. There's one for Abnormal Entertainment. There's one for every show. But there you can find all the links to all the shows. Go to my page. On my pages, you can find the music that I put in my intros and exits, along with photos and bios of some of the folks that have been on the show, extra information that we might put on there about things that we talk about. It's always fun. It's exciting to do intro and exit songs for every episode that I make. So at some point, there will be a compilation CD for sale somewhere with all the music. Let's see, what else can we talk about? I want to thank all the guests that have been on the show. You know, if I'm putting this correctly in my calendar, this show is airing March 20th, which would be, is it March 20th? I think it is. Anyway, I'm not going to even put a date now because I'm going to get confused. But today's guest, let me go ahead and bring today's guest, because I'm sure we're going to have a lot to talk about. And I'll go in and do some more of the information on the exit. But this my guest today, I've actually wanted to have him on my show for a long time. It just hadn't really happened. He has a really tough schedule. He gets up early, goes to bed early. Not because he's old. It's just that his job calls him to do that. I'm not going to tell the story about how this man almost stopped me from having a podcast career. I'm not going to go there because it's been told many times. But he is very influential in me continuing with the network. Mr. Camm Harston. Hello, Mr. Camm Harston.
Hey, Garza. How are you doing?
I'm doing good, sir. How are you?
Not bad. You know you want to tell the story.
I don't want to.
The story's been told many times, though.
It's been told many times. I think some of my listeners already know it. But now that you've suggested it.
Oh, I suggested it.
And because you're the producer, I have to listen to you.
Right.
The story goes, picture it, Christmas, 2011.
go to girls, I like it.
So I did a host spot on, if you guys remember Matt Grenier, he was on a show, on a network at one time. I was a guest on his show a couple of times, and on the second episode that I did for him, I actually did like a whole 35 minutes of his show, and I actually ha-ha'd. I was like, ha-ha, you should tell your producers to give me my own show. Well, he brought it up to them, and Mr. Harston, I don't want to put words in your mouth.
I'll put the words in my mouth. I was not immediately on board. It's how I would put it. No, that's pretty accurate. I wouldn't be a minute about it, but I had some misgivings. I didn't know if you, with all your positivity and this is not sarcasm, this is the truth, or mm-hmm. how positive of a person you are, and how what other adjectives am I looking for?
Spiritual, enlightened.
Spiritual and enlightened. Yes, those are good ones.
Adorable.
that too. But there's always room for adorability. I just didn't know right offhand, which I have admitted many times after this, I was completely wrong, but I didn't know right offhand if that would be a good fit for us.
Well, I'm kind of curious, and on a serious note, was it because the network pretty much had a lot of, more crass podcasts, everything was a little more crude?
That's exactly it, and that would have been a huge my bad for... I guess I had tunnel vision, and I was, I was thinking that this is where we are right now, this is the lane that we're in, and I kind of just wanted to stay there. So happy that I was wrong about that, and because having you on the network has, you know, completely just changed the entire spectrum of... the categories and the genres of shows we have in general, and like, you are the breath of fresh air.
Aww.
to our network. We have, and I think after you, we've kind of expanded even more. There's more sane people on the network now.
Let's not start throwing out big words there, Mr. Harston. I've met some of these people.
Sane is a small word with a big meaning, you're right.
Yeah. Well, you know what? It kind of makes sense, because I do remember listening to the network a little bit before Matt brought me on, and I was like, ooh, I don't know where I fit in with this. And it was, and then, of course, I got launched the same week that the BS Boys, the BS Carnival got sent out.
Yep.
And we were very opposite shows.
Polar opposites.
And I said it a lot of times when I would announce them, I'm like, I get drunk just listening to them on the show. mm-hmm. Which, by the way, I know they still listen, so Mr. Brown and Mr. Salas, if you're listening, how you doing, guys? We miss you. But, okay, so this show is about you, not about me. So anyway, guys, the end of the story is that I came on, I did my pilot, he liked it, not before being saved by Mr. Moyers. And
I loved it. Nay, liked. It wasn't liked. I loved it.
Yeah. So that first pilot that you guys hear, and if you guys want to go back to the archives, that very, very first show was really not meant to be aired. It was just my test pilot to see if I could hack it. And luckily enough, it went up. And again, the rest is history. I'm trying to figure it out because we're actually recording this way ahead of time. But we'll figure it out. But I think by the time this show airs, I've either hit 100 episodes with both my shows, or I've already hit more than 100 episodes. So we'll figure out where this is going to land.
Yeah, man. But, look at you. We're very proud.
I know, right? Mr. Moyers brought that up because we just did his... from when we're recording today's episode, his is airing this week. And we were just thinking about that. It's like, wow, And okay, so the purpose of having you on the show is because Mr. Moyers has been on the show twice now. Yeah. Our producer. He was on episode 7, which I had just started. I remember I was so nervous. And it was kind of like today. It was kind of like we were online. It's like, what are you doing? Nothing. What are you doing? I'm like, I should have you on the show sometime. And he was like, well, click on now. Let's do it now. I'm like, oh, crap.
Yep. Okay. I am long overdue. And yes. There's no time like the present. I'm off from the 9-to-5 gig today. So I wasn't doing too much at home. So I had time. Let's do it.
Let's do it. So, okay. So let's start from the beginning. Where does Camm Harston come from? Tell us about him as a kid.
I was born in Los Angeles, California, raised in Compton, California. And at the time when I was raised in Compton, California, you don't hear that much about Compton. I think Compton still has some of the stigma surrounding it. But, you know, in the 80s when I was, you know, a wee tot and growing up in Compton, it was pretty much everything that you heard about it was absolutely 100% true. So it was a rough neighborhood, to say the least, to grow up in, but, you know, I fared well. I survived. My mom kept me in Catholic school my entire life, which I think helped a little bit because we had some of the goody-goodies, but the Catholic school, you got to keep in mind, the Catholic school was also in Compton, California, so there were still some Compton-type kids. We were all Compton kids, but there was still some of what you think of stereotypical Compton riffraff in my school, so it was slightly better, but it helped. But then again, it was kind of like Catholic public school in the same breath.
Right. So looking back on those, because I'll admit, I'm from Texas, so the only idea that I had about Compton was what I saw in movies. And anytime you turn on the news, and there was some other drive-by, or there was some high-speed chase through Compton or something. Mm-hmm. How does that influence who you are now, having been in that situation as a kid?
You know, I think it has made me a little bit tougher. You know me, and anybody who knows me knows I'm not per se a tough person, but just maybe in mind frame and somewhat in my exterior it made me, at least, for lack of a better phrase, be able to portray that I can get things done, and that I'm tougher. And sometimes it's true. Sometimes it's, you know, just big talk, to fend off any oncoming potential danger. But that I can definitely attribute that to growing up in a rough neighborhood. Yeah, sure.
Well, I mean, I think one thing that people might not know listening to the shows is that we're kind of scattered all over California and Arizona. So you and I have actually only seen each other once?
Whoa.
Arizona trip?
Yeah, that's it, right?
Yeah, we've only seen each other live and in person on last year when we went to Arizona.
And then
we spent like 4 days together.
Yeah, it was a long extended weekend, but yeah, it was just that one occasion. That's true.
But the few times that I've, not the few times, we actually chit-chatted. We used to chit-chat a lot more. We don't as much anymore because everything is just so automated and we just upload ourselves. But there was a time, just for everybody listening, there was a time when I would connect with Mr. Harston once a week and through Skype, and we would connect and send him my shows. So we would have like an hour of chatting or whatever.
Mm-hmm. It was a little bit of work and a lot of gay talk.
Yes, definitely.
that was our gay talk time, and I miss it.
Yes, and we don't get to do that much anymore. So this is a real treat to actually have you on the phone. But I do have to say that from my end, there is this exterior shell about you that either people either take the time to get to know and break through, or it automatically like deflects you, like you just don't want to get part of it. Do you think that growing up in a rough neighborhood could have given you that?
I think it's part neighborhood. I think it's part cultural background. I think it's, I just alluded to the fact that you and I have a gay talk. So in case anybody is living under a rock and didn't know that I too, you and I both have in common that we're both gay. that yes. That's the official announcement. I am gay, and I think it's part cultural. When I was growing up, just my family at home, friends outside of the home, especially kids in the schoolyard, just the last thing ever that you ever wanted to be accused of was being gay. And at that time, I think at some point in my childhood, maybe, you know, fourth grade through seventh grade, somewhere around there, I was a lot more effeminate. I was a lot more outwardly showing signs of being gay. And and somewhere along the line, I quickly learned that wasn't going to be beneficial for me.
Okay.
So I kind of, you know, part out of survival mode, and I don't think it was a life and death situation. It wouldn't have been that bad. But when I say survival mode, I mean in interest of not getting my ass kicked daily. Part, I learned to cover that up as a defense mechanism. Well, not as a defense mechanism, but as a way to, like I said, not get my ass kicked daily.
Well, it sounds like it's a survival skill. How old were you when you realized you were gay?
Oh, kindergarten.
Okay. Along with me.
Right, right. Yeah, and I think a lot of us have that answer, kindergarten. For me, I don't know if that's, you know, this a carbon copy automatic answer. For me, it's absolutely true. I remember it was kindergarten because in kindergarten, I was going to a Catholic school. Like I said, a Catholic school my entire life. When I say my entire life, I don't mean, you know, just middle school or just high school. I mean from preschool until I graduated high school, I went to Catholic / private school. My first time ever going to public school was freshman year of college.
Okay.
So in my Catholic, was it Catholic or private? I think in my private preschool, I remember there was some game, I forget where it was called, where all the little boys would chase the little girls. You know, that's a common thing
right.
at that age. And I was drawn to, and I actually did always chase the little boys. Always. I was always chasing little boys. I had no interest whatsoever in chasing the little girls. And that was frowned upon at my school. The teachers or whoever was outside, you know, monitoring us while we played, used to always explain to me how the game goes. And I'm like, but I don't want to chase the girls. I want to chase the boys. And I remember at one point, this is in kindergarten, I was sent home with a note taped, safety pin to my shirt from my mother. And I forget what it said, but the gist of it was that, you know, I preferred to chase little boys as opposed to the little girls in this game. And it's something that the note suggested that it was something that my parents should look into, and it was definitely frowned upon at that school.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, that note is the way I remember. That note and that stupid chasing game is the way I remember. I definitely realized at the age of five in kindergarten, either four or five, that I was definitely more interested in boys than girls.
Already torturing the boys so young.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now, because that really brings up a whole like spectrum of like tortures. First of all, you're frowned upon by the school for basically being gay. That's what they were saying.
Mm-hmm.
You live in an area that being gay could actually, I mean, I know you kind of put it kind of lightly, but I would think that in a neighborhood where it's really frowned upon just by the culture, you had to hide it. So
right.
Now that's two. How old were you when your parents found out you were gay?
Well, my father died when I was 16, going on 17 years old, my senior year of high school. So at that point, I hadn't told any of my family, so he never found out. I told my mom when I was either 21 or 22. Was it? I think somewhere around 21. Yeah.
And how did that? How does that come about?
Well, that came about. I was in the Air Force at the time. I took the and I wrote her a letter. You know, a lot of us do that. I'm like, I'm not going to have this conversation. This conversation is a long time coming, but I do not have the balls to do it face to face or on the phone.
So you weren't one of those over Thanksgiving is like, Mom, can I have some more mashed potatoes? And by the way, I suck dick for a living.
Yeah, one of those. Pass the stuff in, and by the way, I'm gay as fuck. No, I did not have the balls for that. I wrote her a letter, a handwritten letter. That's how you can tell it was 1999 or so.
Wow.
A handwritten letter. And she ran through the entire gamut of emotions in her reply letter back to me. I think it took her maybe about a week to, for the letter to get back to me. And, you know, in the all in one letter, she went from kind of upset and confused, slightly angry, to sad, to going religious on me and you know,
right,
quoting verses and reminding me what the Bible says about such things, to, okay, that was all included in the first letter. And then the second letter, which was maybe about a week or so later, it was the whole, you're still my son and I love you no matter what. That it was that letter.
It's, oh, wow.
So,
okay, so now you threw in a whole other, okay, so school,
mm-hmm,
neighborhood, family, and then you said Air Force?
Right, I was in the Air Force. I was in
so
Air
now,
Force.
So now there's four things in your life that pretty much...
All of which were being gay is not cool.
Correct. How, and I don't have any other definition, what kind of a mindfuck does that create for you?
It was a pretty huge one. It was a pretty huge one, but at the same time, I was kind of used to it. Like, at that point, like I said, it was early 20s when I had all four of those in common, if you're going to include the Air Force. And at that point, I had, in my early 20s, I had already been sexually active for years and sexually active with men for years. So I was it a mind fuck? Absolutely. Certainly. Sure was. But I was used to it. Like, for me, being gay was equated with sneaking around. So,
like, oh, wow.
There's, yeah, it's a, it, on one hand, it's a mind fuck, and it, sure, it would be cool for people to know and for me to be able to tell my friends and for my mom to be able to know and all this stuff. But, and you know, in my head at the time, I'm like, well, that's just not the way it is for me. So I do this my way, and my way right now is sneaking around at, in dark, shady places at random, right, random times of the night. And that's the way it's going to be for now.
So there's something that you said that caught my attention. You said you had been sexually active and sexually active with men. So there were females,
yes,
along the way?
Yes, yes. There were females along the way. My very first sexual experience ever was with a man. And that was a one, that was one-time thing, I think, when I was 13 or 14. But after that, for about 2 or 3 years, there was nothing, no sets at all. And then after that, it was all females. And at some point, it was all females sprinkled in with the little dudes in the background on the side on the down low. I've had long-term relationships with girls, but I've never had, I've never been faithful to a girl. There was always some random faceless man, men on the side somewhere.
That sounds, in my head, it was kind of like, yeah, I eat vagina, sprinkled with penis once in a while.
I never said I ate vagina. Let's clear that up right the hell now. I never said that. And I never
It was just a metaphor. I didn't, let's not get into the specifics.
Yeah,
we've had that conversation before. We might bring it up in a minute.
Podcasting 101, don't make the guests throw up.
Yes, no, never. It hasn't happened yet, so. So, going through the timeline, so you're gay from very early on. Your first experience is with a man.
Right.
You start dating women. Why did you start dating women?
I started dating women because at that time it was still, it wasn't the 80s anymore. It was early 90s at this point. And early 90s for me, the timeline would be, you know, I'm 14, 15, 16. You know, the high school age where all the boys are dating girls. Things hadn't really changed much up until that point. It wasn't the 80s anymore. And, you know, I was a little bit more mature than I was. Yeah, still a kid, but a little bit more mature. Definitely not mature enough to stand up for myself and grow a pair. There was, and I didn't have any examples either. There was absolutely zero out. There's some kids that I can look back now and be like, oh, this guy was gay, this girl was gay. All these people were gay, I can see now. But there was nobody that was out. nobody that was out and proud. Everybody, you know, was pretending to be heterosexual.
Right.
I wasn't going to be the first. I didn't have that big of a pair of balls to just go ahead and jump out the closet and you know, be the martyr. So I did it because I felt like I had to. It was just not in vogue to be gay at that time. It was a completely different time.
So that, okay, because I get that. I dated girls in junior high and high school. I never had sex with a woman, but I did date a lot of girls. Not that they didn't try, let me tell you.
Of course not. Look at you.
You know, I say that every day. okay, so you're dating women, an occasional dude. What motivates you going into the Air Force?
Okay, and really quick, bookmark that. We're going to talk about what motivated me to enter the Air Force. But okay. You said something that made me think, like, you dated women, you never had sex with them. I don't know how you got away with that, because I dated women, and it was, like I said, it was long-term or at least medium-term. You know, but once you get to, I found that in my situations, once I got, you know, 4 or 5 months in, if you're not having sex with these girls, and, you know, everybody's all a big group and all a big clan. So everybody knows everybody's business, and all the girls are talking to each other and all the guys are talking to each other. At a certain point, some months down the line, if you're not having sex, this actually happened to me. If there's a particular girl I'm not having sex with, I'm doing all I can not to have the sex. And, you know, so she starts talking to her friends, the girlfriends, and then the girlfriends start talking to their boyfriends, which are my friends. Next thing you know, the whole group knows, hey, like, Cam's not fucking this girl. What's going on? And so it's like, eventually, I felt like at the time, it's all going to catch up to me. There's going to be questions. If I'm not, you know, having a physical relationship with this girl, then there's going to be problems, and there's going to be gossip, and there's going to be rumors, and then I'm going to end up getting found out. So that's why, as much as I didn't want to, that's why and how I always eventually ended up going ahead and doing the physical thing with the relationship with girls.
Okay.
So I don't know how, if I am allowed to ask you a question on your own podcast, how did you avoid that? I mean,
well,
how,
you are the producer. I guess you can. I'll allow it.
Thank you.
I break up with them. I would break up with them. It was always, you know, things were more important. But I was that kid in junior high and high school that was involved in everything. So there was always something to do. There was some kind of sports thing to do, or I was in dance and drama through junior high and high school.
And they never knew you were gay in dance and drama.
You know, you would have thunk it by now, right? There was always something. There was always something going on, and I could just avoid it. Well, junior high was kind of weird because we were kids, and it was about. I was pretty popular. So girls wanted to go out with me just because I was popular.
Right.
They really didn't care anything. It was a social. It sounds like I was all that, but I was a kid that had moved from Texas.
Mm-hmm.
I was American. So for the girls in junior high, it was a status. If you were seen hanging out with me, they were like, "Ooh, you know, Daniel is buying them a soda.
Right.
Daniel's dating with them." So I wasn't really hot looking or anything, but I was just popular, and I had dollar bills in my hand, so that was the thing. I was basically a junior high sugar daddy for girls.
Right, right.
Basically,
it was kind of the same at my school. It was definitely a status thing. For me, it was half emphasis on looks. If the little boy or the little girl was cute, that's half of it, and then also of course how popular you are.
Right. Junior high, that's how it was. It was popularity. And my junior high was in a very crappy part of town, and I lived in a better class. So it was more about popularity than anything else.
Right.
It was for the girls that lived in a crappy side of town, sitting with me for lunch meant that I would buy them lunch sometimes, and they ate well.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a 13-year-old sugar daddy. Now, isn't that the title of a good show?
Exactly.
And then in high school, I was involved in a lot of group activities. And usually I was paired up with whoever was left over. So if one girl was single, I was like, okay, well, you're with her. I'm like, all right, cool. I got out of kissing a lot of girls because I was a smoker then. Uh-huh. So like, oh, I hate it when you smoke. When you smoke, don't kiss me.
You were like, well, bitch, give me another cigarette.
I'm going to give me another cigarette. And then I started my last two semesters. I was hanging out with the rough crowd in school. I went from very preppy to very, like, edgy, I guess.
Right.
And I was still in drama, and I was still a dancer, and always active. So there was never time for dating. And if I dated somebody, it was mostly because we got hooked up by somebody, and we connected, and they were like, well, my cousin's coming along. Do you want to meet her? Am I char? We'd get hooked up, and then I'd see them a couple of times. In fact, one of my last girlfriends, I was dating her, and I hooked up with her brother. I had sex with her brother.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah, so I would come home. She had after-school activities, and I had after-school activities, but mine were done earlier. Mm-hmm. So I would go meet her at her house, and her brother was already there. And he was like a year older, so I knew him from high school.
Yeah.
And one thing led to another, and we ended up making out. And, well, every time I went, he was like, do you mind waiting at my house? I'm like, of course not. No.
Hell no.
I will be there. I'll be there 2 hours earlier if you want me to. And her and her brother would get it on for a little while, and then she'd get home, and she'd be like, I love the way you get along with my brother. I'm like, yeah, me too. He's cool, man. No, he's cool.
Yeah.
I dig him and his penis.
that sounds straight out of some type of, some type of porn, one of those porn blog sites.
Yeah, right?
But no, I've never had that. I've never been so lucky.
And then again, this was in Mexico too, so I can relate to your neighborhood and my neighborhood. I was a popular kid. I was the babysitter for the kids. I had a lot of affair with dads in the neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
Those were my first experiences, older dudes. But I can relate to that part. Going back to you, I can relate to that part of the neighborhood. I kept a really good appearance for people.
Yeah.
And I was a brown noser, and I did everything for the moms, and anytime they needed anything. Because in my group now, we call it the mustard ketchup effect. It's like you're looking for everything else on the table, and I'm like, here's the ketchup. here, look at the ketchup.
Right, yay. Right.
So just to hide the rest of the stuff. So I can relate to that. And I can relate to how you learn to just live that way.
Right,
It becomes second nature to be secretive.
Right.
And
that was mostly junior high. High school things change. Cause high school is when puberty kicks in. My first freshman and sophomore year of high school, I was part of the nobody crowd. There was, a handful of us who had all gone to junior high together. And we were just kind of the... Not nerds, not geeks, not dorks. Not that there's anything wrong with that, especially these days. Those are glorified words, and I like that. That's good. But we weren't any of those things, but we were just regular kids, but we were also were not cool. We were just, kind of the nobodies in the corner by ourselves. We knew each other from 7th, 8th grade, and we stuck together for pretty much two solid years straight of high school. A weird thing in junior high, I got... really good at not at sports in general. I didn't play sports, but all 4 years I did run track. That was my one sport.
Okay.
Freshman and sophomore year I was just figuring it out, and junior year I got really really good. I started the older kid who was training me. I started beating him in events, and I was moved up to varsity. I just and I was a hurdler. Hurdles were my thing. I just got really good at hurdles during junior year, and then all of a sudden. It was this culture shock because I was good at my one sport, I was kind of thrust into the popular crowd, and okay. It was a weird dynamic. I'm like hanging with all the cool kids now, and I'm out going to parties on the weekend, and then that's when I started having beer and stuff for the first time, and trying weed, and but it was just. It was like it seemed like overnight. I blinked my eyes and I was a part of the popular crowd. I spent the first 2 years being nobody, and junior year and senior year I was highly popular. And that's when, as far as girls go, that's when that really came into play. My first 2 years, I didn't have to worry about girls. No girls were looking at us. No guys were looking at us as, you know, as friends or enemies or nothing. We were just back there in the corner. Nobody saw us. Now, all of a sudden, I'm popular, and all the popular kids have girlfriends, and all the popular kids are having sex with their girlfriends, and now I'm a popular kid. So what the fuck do I do now?
Wow.
And that's kind of where that's really, really started.
And how old were you then, jumping over now? How old were you when you went into the Air Force?
I was 21. I was 22, but it was just 6 days after my 22nd birthday.
So oh, wow.
I turned 22, and I left for the Air Force 6 days later.
Okay, so how does that transition? How as a gay, and I'm gonna all the attitude, as a gay black man,
mm-hmm.
How do you go into the Air Force? Do you fit in right away? Does it take a while?
I fit in right away, and that's one thing about me. Maybe back to the way I grew up. I always do. Still to this day, I fit in. Even though now at this day, anybody who will listen, if you get 5 minutes worth of conversation in with me, you'll know sooner or later, you'll know that I'm gay. There's no secret. It's no big secret. It's no big deal to me. I'm not one of those people that shouted at the top of my lungs at a rooftop, but I definitely don't deny it like I did before either.
I mean, you're definitely, from what I know you, you've never shied away from an honest and sincere conversation, and I think you don't need to wear your pride colors everywhere you go,
right.
But you're not, again, yeah, so I get it. That's pretty cool.
Right, but back, so, as far as the Air Force goes, I think I adapted just fine. It wasn't a rough transition for me. Even though I was in my very early 20s, 21, 22 at the time, I was still used to, you know, being the same kid that I was at 16, 17, 18, 19. I'm just in another situation where this is in the background, and I just present who I am. I'm still the same exact person, except the only lie that I told was just being interested in girls, and I had a couple Air Force girlfriends too. Back to that same old, fell back into that same routine, because when in Rome,
of course. So, this is going to be the probably not the first stupid question, but a stupid question. Difference between dating men and, well, you say you haven't been in a relationship with men.
No, I've definitely been in a
relationship. You were in a relationship with men. I'm sorry.
Right.
Difference between dating men and women. What would be in your mind one of the big differences? Other than the obvious.
Right. Other than the obvious, the sets, that's obvious. We don't even need to discuss that. That's a no-brainer. For me, the best answer I can give is, you know, women are great. Nothing against women. For me personally, it wasn't just the sets was, like I said, that's one thing. It wasn't the sets. It was just everything else outside of sets felt wrong. Having non-sexual intimacy with a woman and, you know, holding a woman's hand and on the couch behind closed doors, cuddling up and watching a movie with a woman and calling a woman babe and honey, and I think it just always felt strange. As it would feel for, you know, a straight guy to be doing all the things with another man. That's exactly how I felt. It was just strange. Like, there was a disconnect there. Like, this is just, for me, is not natural. So all this is weird. Like, it was just a very, very weird dynamic. And then there's just, in general, when it comes to men's brains versus women's brains, I can never, you know, if straight men can't figure out, and straight men try their best to figure it out, because they ultimately, their goal is to be happy in a relationship and with the undertone of being able to have sex and fuck these girls, right? If straight men can't figure it out, and they're trying to gain a reward, I wasn't even trying to gain no reward, so I really couldn't figure it out. I'm like, I'm over here trying to figure out what is wrong with this woman and her different mood swings, and what am I in this for? Like, there's no payoff for me. I'm just doing this to save face. So it was always a weird thing.
So what was it during your Air Force stay that was your last female relationship?
Yes, it was. I had my Air Force girlfriend became pregnant, which is...
Oh.
Yeah, my Air Force girlfriend became pregnant, and by me, of course. Yeah, when I say became pregnant, that sounds a little...
Yeah.
Sound like there's room for...
Immaculate conception.
Right. It sounds like there's room for some type of scandal there. Her and I made a baby together, but it didn't turn out to be a baby because she had a miscarriage.
Oh, wow.
After she had the miscarriage, you know, I just sat down and thought, because at that point she was, I think, number four on my list of, not just on my list of girls. I had more than four girls, you know, a decent handful of physical relationships, maybe a dozen or so, but four long-term relationships with women.
Women, yes.
With women's. I can't even say it naturally in terms of relationships. But yeah, she was the fourth and final one. And after our relationship, which was close to 2 years, after the miscarriage, and then I had gotten some trouble with the Air Force, so I went away for a while. And by went away, I mean I went to jail for 5 months, Air Force, oh, wow. Military jail. And after I came back, I had five long months to think about this whole, about everything, but specifically about relationships with women and relationship with this one girl that I was, you know, even though I was gone for 5 months, we carried on with the relationship, and she wrote me and sent me stuff all the time. But that whole 5 months, I was thinking about not only just her, about all the previous women too. And I'm like, this is what I came up with is really, really, you know, at this point I am, I think I'm like 24, 25. And I'm like, this is, you know, going on 10, 11 years of me hiding something about myself. And also, I'm hiding something about myself. So if I get rid of this burden, I'm assuming that I'm going to be a happier person. Everybody says once that weight is lifted, then I'm going to be happier. So I'm holding on to that. But even more so, I'm like, it's really not fair to these women. I keep getting involved with these women, and I keep making these women fall in love with me. And then, you know, eventually I have to break up with them. Up until that point, I had never told any of the girls why I broke up with them. The honest truth, look, I'm gay, this is why it's not going to work out. I had any other excuse but for that. But yeah, I started feeling bad for the current woman and all the girlfriends past. And then on top of that, I had got this girl pregnant and she had a miscarriage. And I'm like, this is just not fair to these women. It's really not to make them catch feelings for me and have all these feelings wrapped up. And in my head, I know it's never, ever going to work long term. Just for the simple fact that I'm gay, and that's not going to work. But so, during my 5 months away, I decided that, you know, once I got out of jail, I was going to come out the closet in a letter to my mom. I was going to, even though I was still in the Air Force, I was going to tell all the friends that were close to me and that, you know, I knew I could trust. I was just, in essence, I was going to come out the closet once I got out of jail. I did all of that. I broke up with the girlfriend. I didn't come out the closet to her. I was kind of scared because, you know, at this time it was still don't ask, don't tell. And you know, I can break up with her. That's fine. But I can't.
Right.
I was, you know, a woman. I don't know if she was going to be scorned or she was going to be okay with it. But I didn't want to run the risk of telling her the reason I broke up with her is because I'm gay while I'm still an active duty military member. You know, because she could take that information and run with it, and then, you know, who knows? I could be going right after I got out of jail. I could have been headed right back. So I didn't want to take that risk, but I did. And, you know, down the line after I got out of the military, I did end up telling her.
Wow. Okay, so that brings me. I love this conversation. I'm going in so many directions in my head.
I'm sorry. I'm all over the place.
No. It's awesome because I'm like, oh wow, I didn't know that about you. now that the military is a little more open about homosexuality within, first question is, do you feel cheated?
I don't feel cheated. I'm very happy that, you know, they finally got their heads out of their asses, and, you know, just got rid of that whole don't ask, don't tell thing. I always thought it was really, really stupid. And of course I would, and a lot of people, that I know that were not homosexual thought, you know, I mean, like, I don't give a shit. You know, you see them on TV. I don't care who serves next to me as long as, you know, we're all fighting the same fight. It doesn't matter, you know, who you go home with. I don't feel cheated. I'm just happy it happened. There's a time for everything. Unfortunately, during my time, just like in high schools nowadays, forget about high school. Started in junior high now. There's kids that my God kids go to junior high with, and they're like, oh yeah, that guy's gay, this girl's gay. And I'm like, but they're in fifth and sixth grade. Like, there was never even a possibility during my time in junior high and high school. So if I was going to feel cheated, I could feel cheated all the way around. But no, I don't feel cheated as far as don't ask, don't tell, or how. I'm just happy everything is becoming more open now. Slowly but surely, but yeah, we're getting there.
Okay, let me regroup in my mind, because wow, we, just in the short time we've gotten such it's amazing how much in, because at that point you're what, 23, 24?
Right, somewhere around there, 24 ish.
It seems like you've gone through a lot in that short period of time. So you get out of the military. I know there was another question I was going to have about the military. I'll have to come back to that. Mm-hmm. You get out of the military, and where do you go? What do you have a plan? Are you going to wing it?
I am definitely going to wing it. Plans, I've never been too big on plans. Sometimes it's intentional, and sometimes I just fly by the seat of my pants and see what happens. I did not have a plan. I got out of the military. I was, due to the trouble that they landed me in jail in the first place, I had to stick around even after I got out of jail, I had to stick around on base in the military for court stuff, for about another 7 or 8 months. And then they finally let me go home. I came back home. I lived with my mom for a little while, eventually found a job and yada, yada, yada. But no, once they put me on a plane, I had no plan. And this was going to be my first time seeing my mom and my family after I came out, and like, hey, I'm back from Colorado and I'm gay now, remember? So yeah, I was nervous about it all, but I was also excited because I'm like, okay, I'm out the military. I'm out the military. My entire family knows now. Once I tell my mom, everybody knows. That I just right. I just let her do the telegram for that.
Okay. So going, here's where my question was going to go. So after having left the military and now you're out, and people know, and is there still a part of you that either does or misses the secretive double life?
Oh wow, that's an interesting question, and an interesting question that nobody has ever asked me before, by the way. So good job on that.
Thank you.
You know, I
put in a good word with my producer on that.
Right, and remember, I'm the guy who's going to edit this show. So anything you say that I don't like, I can take it out, but I'm definitely leaving that in.
Shucks.
You know, I now that you forced me to think about it, I think I would be lying if I said that there is something that I miss about it. There's and I think that might be part of my sexual proclivities, if I don't know if you want to get into that.
Yeah, go. Yeah. It's you're the guest.
I am 100% gay, out, proud, all of the above. But as you know, most of your listeners might not know, out, proud, all that, yes. Active in the community and and frequent gay establishment, clubs, bars, or even necessarily physically attracted to other gay men? Not so much. Not so much. So to the first half of the answer to your question, it was much more exciting when I was deep in the closet and I was sneaking around. Then at that time, I had no problem whatsoever. I'm working this out as I speak. I promise you, Garza, I had never even thought about this.
Okay,
I had no problem whatsoever with gay men. All I wanted was another man to get it on with. It was exciting. It was fun. It was secret. It was taboo. Now that, fast forward all these years later, I'm out and proud. But my main thing is that I'm out and proud. I kind of don't want to fool around with another out and proud guy. I'm into guys that are straight guys, or I call them heteroflexible guys. There's and we all know these guys. There's guys that are primarily straight, but you know, when it comes down to it, it's any port in the storm would do. And those kind of a mouth guys, and some guys are some guys are just horny, and at a certain point at a certain time, with the right time, and anything would do, just for the orgasm.
Right, which what my people call the six pack and a dare kind of guys.
Right, six pack and a dare, and I call them heteroflexible, but whatever we want to call them. That's my target audience, and now that you forced me to think about that, like I was right now, because right now generally, I honestly, to most in general, I'm not attracted to other gay, because I don't feel like there's any challenge there with another gay guy. I like to chase. I don't really like being chased, I like the challenge.
You like the challenge, okay? So, but you have been in a relationship with another man,
right? I've been in a few.
Okay, and so how was it getting into that relationship?
Yeah. How did that whole thing work out?
You've already established that it was more of a secretive kind of, you enjoy the anonymity of, and the shadows of life playing the gay game.
Right.
So when you're in a relationship, it's more upfront. It's knowledge.
Right.
It's common knowledge. How did that fit into your way of thinking?
Okay. There's been exactly three relationships with men, and it covers, about a full decade, but in that full decade, there's been three. There's been many, okay, many hookups, but there's been three long-term men. And I'll try to make it as quick as I can, because they're kind of very easy explanations of how these things happened. The very first guy was a black guy. I haven't mentioned here that I'm really not attracted to black guys. Nothing, just physically not attracted. I'm a black guy myself. I'm not attracted to black guys. Not that big into Asian guys either. If anybody's going to send out some angry letters, might as well include the Asians too.
So, what is your favorite flavor, Mr. Carson?
My favorite flavor is Latinos, of course.
Latinos. So you're for them.
Yes.
And you dig the tacos.
Yes,
got it.
Yes,
okay, cool.
That is my absolute favorite. Puerto Ricans at the top of the list, except for the fact that I live in Los Angeles and there's no Puerto Ricans here. So, but I have no problem with my Mexicans either.
Okay, got it. Just in case there's any new fans out there.
Right.
He does eat Mexican.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, got it.
So my very first relationship with the man, black guy, he was married to a woman with three sons. He lived with his wife. I was always over there. His sons knew me. It was just a weird thing. It was kind of one of those things, like his wife knew what was going on. I don't know why. And he did okay with money, so that's probably why she stuck around. I don't know. She was either not working or working at a job that definitely she couldn't take care of three boys on her own. And the reason that happened is because I was brand new to being out and gay. So I went through a time where I didn't even know how to get the guy that I wanted. So I knew, I eventually found out that I like Latinos and I like white boys. But, you know, when I first started getting out and about, all these black guys just flocked to me, you know, because, you know, I think within any race, a lot of people just stick within their own. So black guys love me. Black guys flock to me. I didn't have any game or any game plan. So, I, you know, at that point, I was just out, brand new out. So I'll take what I can get. And I was, you know, hooking up with all these black guys, and I just wasn't enjoying it. I started even started to question, like, am I even gay? Because I'm like, it's, I mean, it's cool. And I'll get to where I need to be by the end of the night. There will be an orgasm, but this is not, you know, I'm not really feeling this. So, until I had my first Latino guy, and I'm like, oh yeah, no question. I'm definitely gay. It's just, and that part I can't explain. People ask me all the time. I have no idea. I don't think anybody can fully explain their preferences. I don't know. It's just, sexually, physically, I'm not into black guys in general. There's always exceptions to the rule, but in general, no. But I ended up with this guy because, you know, he, like I said, black guys were always coming on to me, and I was hooking up with them. Right. And, you know, it just kind of lingered from there. It started as a hookup, and he was really nice, and he was good to talk to, and he was around my age as opposed to some of the really older black men that I was dealing around with. Okay. You know, I just happened to be a nice guy, and he kind of knew I was green and knew I was brand new. So he kind of just led me through it. And, you know, he kind of just told me that we were dating now. And I just, you know, I was like, all right, I guess we're dating. I don't know. We spent all this time together. So, all right, fine. We're dating. And he keeps buying me stuff and taking care of me and all that stuff. But so that was the first guy. Eventually broke up with him just because I knew this just wasn't my thing. Okay, the second guy was...
Okay, so I need to, before you continue the next one, I need to ask, was it not your thing because he was a black man, or was it not your thing because it was out there, because it was an open relationship? Not open as in, like, you could date anybody, but...
Right, because...
You were honest about being with another man.
Right, right. At that point, it was no secret.
Okay.
But no, this very first time, it was strictly because he was black. Just strictly because, okay, I wasn't feeling it physically.
Okay. Okay.
I gave it, you know, I put in close to a year, and he's...
Wow.
He was a great guy, but, you know, I just had to end it because...
It just didn't work out. Yeah, okay. Just physically. So now the second guy...
The second guy was Latino, and... The reason the second guy stands out is because he took the exact opposite approach. First of all, he stands out because he's Latino. So physically, you know, I'm doing the thumbs up sign, like you can see me like an idiot. physically, thumbs up. He was right there. And we went out all the time, and we had fun, and we had all these inside jokes, and we were always laughing. And so I fell really hard for this dude. And another reason that I fell hard for him is because he took the exact opposite approach of the first guy, the black guy. He kind of just put me on the back burner. He was always out doing his thing, and he would make plans and not show up half the time, or he would show up in the middle of the night when I didn't invite him over half the time, and he didn't exactly talk to me like shit. He wasn't disrespectful to me, but it was just like, he was a bad boy type, and that shit drove me crazy in a good way. Like, really? Yeah, yeah. It was just like, see, I like that challenge. I'm like, oh, this motherfucker is driving me crazy, but watch. I am going to make him fall for me. Watch this. And we that was our relationship. It was never a monogamous on either, but mainly on his part, but it's not on my part either. You know, because it was one of those relationships where we were just always fucking arguing and getting pissed at each other, and then, you know, go screw around with somebody else, but eventually always came back to each other. But that was that was still my most fun relationship to date. And this was only maybe like a year, a little over a year I was with this guy. But it was just, there was just so much, it was just so much arguing and so much fun and all these trips on the subway and going to museums, and him and I both drank a lot, and it was just completely out of my element, out of my character, who I am right now. But I still look back fondly on that relationship because he was just so crazy and so all over the place, and it was just fun to try to keep up with him.
Okay, so basically we're gathering here that if you want to fit into Mr. Harston's world, first of all, if you're Latino, check one.
Yep.
if you're a little challenging, don't make it too easy.
Oh, please
check
don't.
Check two.
Yep.
Correct. Okay. And then we go on to the third relationship. Let's see what we get from that one.
Okay. Relationship number three lasted for a very, very long time. And when relationship number three started, this guy is not Latino, but, so we went from black to Latino to white.
Okay.
This guy is just like a genuine, genuine nice guy. We also had a lot of fun and all that stuff together. It was not as whirlwind and, as crazy as the second guy, but the second guy, you know, towards the end, of course, that's all fun and games in the beginning. You end up getting pretty beat up pretty bad after a relationship like that, right? That mm-hmm. you can't sustain like that forever. So at the time that I met guy number three, the best way to describe it was safe. Like, he's a really, really nice guy, stable family background and head on his shoulders, really intelligent and safe. Guy number three was safe. And and to this day, that's my longest relationship. I don't want to, anybody who listens to any other shows knows who I'm talking about, but I don't necessarily have to put the name out there on each and every appearance that I'm on. But yeah, and yeah, so that lasted for 7 years. And it was great. It's still my most fulfilling relationship to date. But if I'm going to be honest, it just at a certain point, somewhere in the middle, like safe, just got boring for me. Like, this is like I didn't want to go all the way back to the fucking craziness that was guy number two. But that just with guy number three, safe was just like, oh, what am I doing? Like, this is my third time around, and this time I'm really invested. Like, we have. All our families know each other. Think about 7 years. All our families know each other. Everybody loves each other. We have a dog together. I know all the kids in his family grew up with me, and vice versa. And they, you know, like I'm. It's, but
right.
You get to a certain point where it's like, oh, what is right for me? Put aside everybody else involved and all the families, and put aside how much time is spent so far. Like, do you want to go another 7 years like this? It's fine. It's safe. It's cool. Like, I always say about that one, like, I wasn't unhappy, but I wasn't happy. So, you know, and I, you know, after the fact, we both realized, and, you know, him and I both felt the same way. We were just kind of coexisting and not really living life to our fullest as a couple or separately. We were just kind of sticking it out because we had been used to sticking it out for
right.
Not the full 7 years, but for about the last, I think, 3 or 4 years, we were just kind of just rowing along there. So that's yada, yada, yada. Sorry, I said those were going to be short, but that's how the third, that's how the third one ended up.
Well, I think, by the way you're describing it, I mean, You can't just lump up that last relationship in three words or anything.
Right.
Because I don't think a lot of people realize that gay relationships, whatever title you put before the relationship part, it's still a relationship.
Yep, of course.
And you go into it, you know, full of emotions and feelings and it grows. It's just hetero gay, lesbian. You go into it just with the intention of wanting to make it last, and then at some point, things just don't go the way you want it to.
Right.
And it's, even though there's no marriage or paper, it's hard to just walk away from it.
Right. It's really hard. And with my, with that last relationship, be it being 7 years long, I started to feel some type of sympathy for, just imagine if that was a 7 year long heterosexual relationship. By then, most likely there would have been kids involved, either one or more, most likely, and most likely there would have been a marriage performed and a marriage involved. And then, so I started to see, like, oh, because at that time, at the time that we were breaking up, and I was thinking about it in my head, I'm sure, and I come to find out he was thinking about it too as well, but had we had to factor in that there were kids involved and that we had signed these papers and we were married and now there would be divorce proceedings, I would have just happily just went ahead and just like, oh, like I said, this relationship is not bad. I could do way worse than this guy. But I'm, like I said, I'm not unhappy, but I'm not happy. So
right.
I was lucky in the fact that we were both lucky in the fact that the benefit was there was, we didn't have kids to worry about and we didn't have other stuff like that to worry about. But, you know, if one of us was a woman or if there were kids involved, then I can say for myself, I would have just stuck it out. For when I say, do I want to go another 7 years like that? I probably would have gone another 7 years. You don't want to,
right.
You don't want to, you know, because I come from a split up relationship where the kids have to try to figure out what happened to the parents. So, yeah.
And I understand. I mean, I've dated in my gay career. I've dated guys.
Your gay love life career.
Pardon?
Your gay love life career.
You're my gay love life career. I've definitely been in a situation where you date somebody and you get to the point where you're like, what are we even doing? We're just roommates now.
Yeah.
What's going on here?
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but those relationships that have kids, I miss the kids way more than I miss the ex.
Right. Right. Yeah. It happens. It happens.
But, okay. So, wow, we've gone through like a big chunk of your life now. Cause,
I know, I feel all
still,
exposed.
You're still young. How old are you now?
I am 36 years old.
You're 36 years old, so.
Yes.
At this point, after all this relationship, we're hitting 34? 33, 34?
At the end of the last relationship?
Yeah.
We're at about 35 there.
Okay, so just a couple of years ago.
Right. Right.
It
hasn't even been a full 2 years, but it's been a year and some definite change.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So, now, for everybody listening, something I forgot to say at the beginning, Mr. Harston is not only my producer, but he's also the host of his own show. Which one are you on? You're on Raise Your Spirit?
Raise Your Spirit.
Are you doing anything else right now?
I am working on something else right now. Raise Your Spirits is branching off itself, and anybody who listens to Raise Your Spirits, don't get nervous. Raise Your Spirits with Camm and Kevin is staying as is. Every Thursday, we'll be there. When I said branching off, I kind of scared myself. That made it sound like something was going to change. nothing's changing with Raise Your Spirits with Camm and Kevin. But Camm and Kevin...
Why are Mommy and Daddy divorcing?
No, Camm and Kevin are not divorcing. There is no plans for that whatsoever. Let me make that clear. But Camm and Kevin will also go on and do some supplements outside of Raise Your Spirits with Camm and Kevin, which I repeat again, will not affect Raise Your Spirits with Camm and Kevin. And I am also working on another show that will be featured on the network soon. We're working out the kinks for that. So there will be a little bit more Camm Harston on the network in this upcoming year, hopefully in the next, you know, couple months or so.
Now, when I came on to Abnormal Entertainment, you had Success the Podcast.
I did.
Which is an archive now.
Yes.
Which is one of the reasons that I was so intrigued by you when I first met you. I was like, this dude, like, for anybody listening to the network, if you had not had a chance to go to, you know, when you go on the page on the right hand side, you will see where you can subscribe so you can follow us. You see all the links to all the Twitter and Pinterest. But then if you scroll down the list of all the shows, which are on by date, at the bottom, there's an archive section. and you can see everything that's been on. There's the BS Carnival, there's the Rocket Propel Gaming, Ain't Dead Yet. But look there, and there's Success, the podcast.
Right.
Could you tell us about that a little bit?
I can. It's funny how many times I get questioned about Success, the podcast. It was a very short-lived miniseries. It only ran 8 episodes. I plan to go maybe about a dozen or so, see how long I can push it. But the premise for that show was, here I am, a gay guy, as I just described earlier in this show, attracted to straight guys. So how do I make that happen? How do... Because I got that question a lot, and I still get that question a lot. If you're gay and they're straight, how does their penis end up in your mouth? Exactly. How does that work? And does that make them gay? Or are they still straight? And what's the whole deal? And that was kind of what Success was built upon. The shows weren't called episodes. They were called lessons. So it went from lesson 1 to lesson 8. Lesson 1 was kind of introducing myself and just getting the ball rolling on what I plan to talk about, and eventually just went on to how to make it happen, primarily a show for any gay guy listening who also had the same picture for straight guys like I did, which I think a lot of us do. And it was also for people who were curious, who were not even gay. Just, I have straight women, straight men, just everybody's like, I don't understand. How are you doing this? How are you making this happen? Like, these guys are straight. These guys sometimes have girlfriends, sometimes have wives, sometimes have children. And at the end of the night, they're in your bedroom for 45 minutes. I don't understand how.
Right. So for anybody listening, we don't want to give away too much of that, because we want you to go and listen to these. They're not very long. They're actually kind of, they're quick.
Right. They're succinct.
But I invite you to go and listen to these, because this is one of the things that I was like, I want to be on this network.
Really?
I was like, when Matt Grenier invited me to be on his show, and then I would go and find the show so I could listen to it. I remember playing with on the page, and I was like, what is this Success you speak of?
Right.
And then when I heard the first one, I was like, oh, I want to be on this network. I'm like, this is the network where I can talk about anything.
I think that show was received, much to my surprise, it was received pretty well. I've received emails, I've received Facebook messages, and there's more than a handful of people out there that have been wondering, like, what happened to Success? But like you said, I do want people to go back and listen. But a lot of people have been asking me to bring it back. What happened with that is there's just a finite timeline. I can explain my theories on the subject. I can explain how I do things. I can give suggestions on how other gay guys can try to make these same things happen. And at a certain point, which for me landed on episode 8, you know, everything was explained. Everything was, every base was covered. If you listened to me and did everything right, and if all the stars aligned, then you ended up with your own straight guy. And I put all the things in play for you to go out into the world and do. And at that point, it's like, there's nothing more I can say, really. But who knows? There could be some ever-expanding version of Success down the road. Who knows?
Who knows? I mean, you know, the way I look at it is like 8 inches is about a good size. So eight episodes,
right,
should
exactly.
be about it. 8 lessons should be a pretty good thing. Maybe. Learn life in 8 lessons. That's a pretty cool thing.
Right. Maybe if I do bring it back, I will amend it, and it will be, it will be inch 1 from inch 1. Maybe I can do 8 or 9 more inches.
You're welcome for that idea. You're welcome.
I'll take it.
So how did you get into, and we're going over the hour, but that's cool. How did you get into podcasting?
Well, I got into podcasting, well, before Abnormal Entertainment, I was working with another show. I wasn't on air. I think I was on air a little tiny bit. I was producing that show. And, you know, it was a brand new show. I jumped in towards the beginning, and I was there for, you know, 2 or 3 months before they decided it was a husband and wife team, and they decided that they wanted to just go ahead. They took a long break. They were deciding that they were going to continue their podcast in general. So they took a break. Once they came back from break, they decided they wanted to go it alone. They didn't want the producer, which was, you know, no hard feelings there. So I parted with that show. And at the time of parting with that show, Kevin Moyers, my co-host, and was still a good friend of mine back then. I think we've grown even closer as friends now that we talk all the time. Like, that's all we do now is talk, mostly about show stuff or just podcasting together has brought us closer because we talk all the time, all the fucking time. I talk to that man every day. I'm surprised. It's no wonder we're not sick of each other. Sometimes maybe we are sick of each other. But right around the same time, I can't remember, give or take a few days before or after, right around the same time that I got canned from the other gig, he was thinking about expanding to Abnormal Entertainment. At that point, the only show, I believe, on the network was Cinema Head Cheese, the podcast. Okay. And that had been in place for a while then. And that was the only show on the network, the only podcast on the show at that time. He had Kevin Hates Everything, but it wasn't in podcast form, I believe, at that time. It was just a weekly blog.
Blog, okay.
So he approached me and asked me, did I want to do a podcast together? I'm like, well, fuck it. I was nervous about it. Like I said on the other show, I was a producer. I'm not used to getting in front of a microphone and talking. But I'm like, yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. I'm nervous as hell, but let's do it. And so at that point, it was just full steam ahead from that point. As soon as I said, yeah, give us a couple of weeks and we were on the air. The second show, the second podcast on the Abnormal Entertainment Network.
Okay. And I don't want to get into this part too much because I'm sure you talk about it. But what has been your experience? How do you feel about the world of podcasting?
Well, I love it. Actually, I love it. I can go back and listen to some of the older shows, and sometimes still to this day, I cringe at myself because I fumble. And now at this point, I accept it, but it's kind of what I'm known for. I fumble over my words, and especially on our show is a drinking show. And I take the yes, raise your spirits. The spirits part is not a spirits, a Daniel Garza version of spirits. Our spirits is actual physical liquor that we raise every week to our lips. Yes. So I especially fumble more of my words on our show because I'm always drinking on that show. Sometimes I drink a little bit more than I should. And the fumbling over words gets worse, but and I think there's a place for that. I've had just a few people like, oh, what's up with all the, you can't even, you know, get your thoughts out correctly, but over time, and we've been on the air for I want to say like a year and a half now. We're at 82 episodes now.
Wow.
We're at 82 episodes, so I know 52 is a year, so a year plus 30 episodes. I don't even attempt to get me to do math.
Nope.
So that's...
There's no quiz on the show.
Okay, good. So we've been on the air for that long, and I think at this point, the feedback I'm getting is most people that... I don't know if it's... They're either used to it or people are welcoming and accepting of me fumbling over my words because it's kind of what I'm known for now. But to answer the question, which I just got sidetracked because I was fumbling over my words, to answer your question, yeah, I love podcasting. And that's how I got on the words thing because I would go back and listen and be like, oh, I don't sound like Adam Carolla. Like, everything is so perfect and I just don't have that. but I've learned to love that and appreciate that about myself. On our show and on mic and off mic, I often ask Kevin Morris, like, what's the word I'm looking for? You tell me, because I don't know. And I'm fumbling over these words, and it's just the person who I am. So why I spent a lot of time trying to change that in the beginning and trying to sound perfect, like an Adam Carolla or some of the other big podcasters, and I just eventually came to realize that, like, that's not me. I need help, and I fumble over my words, and people seem to like it, and that's who I am in real life, so let's keep it.
Well, you definitely, from not from a brown-nosing podcaster of the network, by all means, not from that angle.
Of course.
From a listener point of view, you guys make a great team. I've had the pleasure of guest hosting with you a couple of times,
mm-hmm.
For Mr. Moyers, which has been quite entertaining.
Always. We got a song out of it once. I don't think
a lot of my listeners know about these episodes because I don't advertise them.
you are we your dirty little secret?
You are. You know, it's like, I don't have another word for it. It's like when I would go and do stuff with the BS boys, and it was just those little times when I didn't have to be spiritual or connected, and I could be a dude and just mm-hmm. hang out and cuss like a sailor.
Yep.
And because Lord knows, not even 10 minutes on your show and I'm out there. So for everybody listening on Put It Together, I will find the episodes. I just outed myself on that one.
Yep.
I will find the episodes and I'll post them on the Facebook page so you guys can go and listen the dirtier, raunchier side of Daniel Garza.
Now, are you talking about the raunchy with the BS Carnival or with Racial Spirits?
Well, I think I'm both on all episodes. Anytime I'm around you or Mr. Salas or Mr. Brown, it's like this immediate, as you call it, dirty Garza. No, what was it? Cranky Garza one day?
Oh, yeah, there's Cranky Garza and there's Dirty Garza.
There's Dirty Garza.
Everybody loves Dirty Garza.
Yeah, one time you and I were chit-chatting and I was in a grumpy mood and I was being facetious uh-huh. on Facebook and you were like, I like Cranky Garza. but I think, yeah, Dirty Garza, for those of you that have never heard the dirtier side of me, I've talked very freely on my show about things, but never as free as I have on Raise Your Spirits.
Right.
But I will own up to it. I will post those shows on Facebook so you guys can listen to them.
And also thank you for the compliment about Kevin Morris and I having chemistry. I kind of get that a lot too. So that's I like to hear that even at this stage in the game. We're a year and a half. We'll blink our eyes and it'll be 2 years soon.
Yeah.
But I'm one of the, this is the complete opposite for Kevin, but I'm one of those people who still sometimes, well, always, no matter what, on my deathbed, I will still have doubts. Like, is this really good enough? Or did I do this right? Or did I do that right? Kevin's the exact opposite, which is maybe that's part of the chemistry. We balance each other out that way. But yeah, it's always, I get that fairly often. Like, you guys have good chemistry. And I like to hear that. So thanks for saying that.
Well, one of the cool things is you have that. You have each other to, after this long of a time, you have each other to fall back on. Mm-hmm. Where one ball drops the ball, the other one picks it up. Because let me tell you, after doing a year of shows by myself and finding guests, and I think I'm one of the few shows on the network that has guests almost every week. And having a guest that doesn't know your style,
right,
and doesn't understand your sense of humor,
mm-hmm.
and I mean, you guys listen to every show that we put out, and I'm sure you've heard those where I try to be funny and the guest doesn't get it.
Oh,
like,
yes, have we ever?
Yeah, and you hear the chirping in the background, and I'm like, well, moving on.
Yeah, there's been a couple of shows. We of course will never name names. There's been a couple of shows where I'm like, oh, poor Garza, come on, boy. Now it's time for you to earn that pretty much non-existent paycheck. You're gonna have to pick this up.
Oh my God,
you're gonna
yeah.
have to pick this up because this person is not exactly on the same page as you. So,
and yeah, and for those of you listening, you've probably heard shows where I interview for about 25 minutes, and then I'm like, well, thank you for being on the show. Yep. That should be a hint for you right. that it's not going the way it's supposed to.
Yep. But that being said, we still appreciate the guests.
Yes, we do. We do. I love all my guests. Everybody has brought something to the table, and it's awesome. But for any future guests, please just know that I encourage you to speak. We want you to talk on the show.
Mm-hmm.
If the less talking I do, the more interesting the show, I think, sometimes. So what's ahead? Is this where you want to go at producing and launching and making the communication side of Camm Harston bigger?
That's part of it. That's part of it, yes. Like I said, two new shows in the works. We are constantly revamping and restructuring and doing things to raise your spirits with Camm and Kevin, which for me, that's my headquarters. Like, I feel like the entire network's headquarters is Cinema Head. Cinema Head Cheese is the big dog, and we all fall under that. Excuse me. Cinema Head Cheese has a huge following, and they've been around forever. So for me personally, in my life, I feel like Raise Your Spirits is my headquarters. That's my home base. Everything else falls under that. But the stuff that falls under that is, that list is growing now. So, yeah, there's a couple new shows in the work. Now, shit, you actually had me thinking about revamping Success, the podcast. It might have to be called something else. But that's another thing that I'll jot that down. Also, outside of the network, I am a musician. And I have of late been getting back into rap again.
Oh.
So there's new music on the horizon.
Nice. Well, you have to come on the show when that comes out.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. I'll be back. And it'll be a completely different type of rap. When I was rapping before, I was a rapper making music for over 15 years, I would say.
Oh, wow.
It was all during, it started during high school, went all the way up into college. I was rapping in the Air Force. I made two demo CDs while I was in the Air Force. And then, you know, I kind of gave it up. And now I'm back with one of my former producers, and we are back making music again at long last.
Nice.
But it's a completely different spin now because, like I said, out, gay, and proud. So that would not be. I want to find a delicate balance because I want to weave that into songs. I definitely won't shy away from it. Of course not. But I don't want every song to be a song about, you know, sucking dick, and just every song to be a gay thing. I want it to be known. Right. I want it to be known that I'm a rapper and that I'm gay. But I don't want to be like the Little Kim of gay rappers, you know?
Well, you know, I didn't really know that part of you, which is kind of surprising. Because, you know, I've been busting my ass trying to find friends because with the new show coming out, and you know this because you're on that side.
Yep.
But it's a pain in the ass to find new songs for shows every week.
Mm-hmm.
We might have to sit down together and get some lyrics for you to rap for the new show. Maybe we could have a rap intro for Vida Esposito as a set song.
Man, that works for me. As long as you allow me to do it in English, I can do it.
Well, yeah, because that's going to be a mostly English show, yes. And that's one of the funny
things. That title in English, so you threw me off. You made me nervous.
Yeah, for people listening, you know, I have put it together in Corazón La Mano, which Mr. Harson and Mr. Moyers also edit for me, but they speak no Spanish. So I've been doing almost 40 shows and almost on my own, basically, because nobody really gives me any feedback other than the audience. So I could talk about nasty about them and they never know, which I have not.
Sure you haven't. Yeah.
Ever.
We're very proud of Corazón La Mano, but I can honestly say I haven't heard a single show. I've listened to as much as I need to edit, and then I submit it,
and then it's over.
And then it's over because what can I do?
That's I'm excited. Now we're gonna definitely off the air get together. I have to come to Long Beach so we could like hammer out something I would love to have your voice be the intro song for Vitas for the new show. That would be really exciting.
Hey, man, consider it done. Even before we talk details, I will give you a hard, firm yes right now.
Awesome. So you guys heard it. So when you go over and listen to the new show, when you hear that intro song, that would be Mr. Harston singing a little bit of pre-show trivia there for you.
Yeah.
Well, Mr. Harston, we're almost at an hour and a half, so I'm gonna do my hosting duties and say you're done, sir.
Thank you.
But I'm excited. Before we go, I want you know, part of the new tradition that's been going on at least for almost over half a year is that our guests send a message out to our audience, and of course you're no exception.
Okay.
I would love, and I think you're under this umbrella of so many. Growing up and I'll throw all that out there. Growing up as a gay black man, under so much scrutiny from all the environments that surrounded you growing up,
right?
And yet, I find you a very complex, well put together, interesting man. Definitely somebody I consider a friend.
A handsome friend.
What about a very handsome and delightful friend, may I say?
Thank you.
And smart and intelligent goes without saying, but I'll say it anyway. Wow, that's a lot of brown nosing right there. Shit. If I turn any browner. What advice can you send out there to some, not necessarily black kid, but any kid out there who's living in some kind of situation, or young man similar to what you went through and doesn't know how to come out? Or let me say, not come out necessarily. How to find themselves, because I think that right. The journey that you talked about was all about finding you. So to somebody out there who's still trying to find themselves, what can you tell them?
Right. The only thing I can, and I'm sorry it sounds a little bit cliche, but it's so, it rings so true, especially for me. And I had always heard this, and I just didn't have the balls to believe it and to put it into that and put it into action. But it is very, very true that you have to live your life for yourself. You can't worry about being embarrassed and anything, any ramifications of be it coming out as having an unpopular sexual identity or dressing the way you want to dress or listening to whatever music you want to listen to. Any ramifications that fall from that will be very, trust me, it will be very short-lived, and it will only come at the hands of very small-minded people. And small-minded people generally don't last long in your life. They will come in and out, and there will always be small-minded people. But the more you go on with life and you defeat those small victories and you defeat those small-minded people, trust me, just live your life for yourself. It will always be greater later. Everything is so much easier once you're living your true, authentic self. That's just the honest truth.
Pretty cool. I have one more question before we end it. If you could go back and change anything, would you?
I would not. I definitely would not. I needed that time. I needed that time. Some things I rushed through at lightning speed, and some things I took really, really very slow baby steps with. And I think everything worked out exactly perfectly as it is. I definitely wouldn't change anything.
Well, awesome. Well, guys, this has been a really interesting. I'm so happy that I finally got you on the show. Thank you for taking time out of your day off to sit with me and talk. Before I forget something that I missed, I knew I was forgetting something in that.
Aha!
Because this show will definitely air before we head out. We're going to be in Arizona again.
We are going to be in Arizona again in May.
Yes. You want to tell the folks about that?
We will be back at Phoenix Comic Con over Memorial Day weekend. Don't even ask me what. Memorial Day weekend. Look at your own personal calendars. So it's the last weekend of May, I believe. Is this show that far out? Are we going? Is this? It will be out before,
no,
like you said. But
it would be on before.
We want to start letting you guys know. This, yes. The same as we did last year. The last year when we had a fairly new, brand new budding Daniel Garza along for the ride.
Yeah. Now, actually, Memorial Day is Monday, May 27th. So we'll be okay. there that weekend.
See, now this year when it comes to Phoenix Comic Con, you're going to be an old pro. This is your...
I am.
Been there, done this.
Whatever, bring it. But, yeah, last year was a blast. We had such a good time. People came on the show from that. Taylor, mm-hmm. Jesse came in, did some stuff. What else?
We gained an intern. I'm not sure what the status with our intern is right now, but we gained an intern from Phoenix Comic Con last year.
Yeah, Nathan.
Intern Ethan.
Ethan, I'm sorry, Ethan. So there was a lot of really cool things that happened. Legs. Yes, and if you go over to my page and scroll down, you'll find pictures of him and on there. But definitely, we look forward to it. I'm hearing rumors. This may be true. I heard it from Mr. Moyers that we might have a bigger stage this year for us. So
yeah, I cannot confirm or deny, but that's the rumors. There's always some slight truth in rumors and stereotypes, I think.
You know, there might be. So if you guys are listening to all the friends that we got over in Phoenix last year and have been listening to us all this year, hello, guys. We're coming back without a couple of members that are no longer with us, but the rest of us and some new members that have joined since. But we'll definitely be there. We look forward to it. So please look for us.
And can I interrupt you one last time please, to please. Say this? Speaking of rumors and speaking of, we are coming back with some people that we lost. But speaking of rumors, we may be coming back with some people who may be returning. Some people don't stay lost forever, is what I'm saying. So you never know who we're going to be rolling up on Phoenix, Arizona Comic Con with.
You heard it here first, folks. You heard it here, folks. First, while Mr. Harston is there, let me go ahead and close up the show. Guys, thank you very much. Remember, go to abnormalentertainment.com. You'll get all the information. All the shows that we've talked about today, all the information is on there. Just check it out along with our sponsor page. Check out the sponsors. You can get everything from HIV tests to covers for your couches. Everything in between. Tickets for sports events. And remember, by clicking on those pages, you kind of help us a little bit. So help us stay on the air. I want to thank all my friends at Stitcher and iTunes, all our overseas friends, all of our friends down south in Mexico and beyond South America. Make sure you go over and listen if you want to hear more about Mr. Harston and Mr. Moyers, which you've seen now they've both been on the show. Go over and catch them on Raise Your Spirits. Their shows come out every...
Thursday,
thank you. Go and pay attention to the other guys. We have shows about everything. We have shows about comics. We have shows about movies. We have shows about wrestling. Anything you want to hear about, we have it available. And I'm pretty sure that by the time this show airs, the new show, Vitas, will be coming out. So pay attention to that one, too. Thank you, Mr. Harston. Thank you, Mr. Moyers. Thank you, everybody. And this is Daniel Garza saying, hey, put it together.
Sits alone at a table in a small cafe, drowning his tears in a bottomless cup of coffee. And he's tumbling into his thoughts. His memories are all tied in knots. Who is going to save him? No one wants to know him. She stands alone in a place where no one knows her name. She catches them staring, they turn around and finish the frame. And nursing her hair than her pride. She died long ago, deep down inside. Who is going to save her? No one wants to know. I can't believe that you pull on the sleeve when you cry.
When you cry,
you'll stick in the knife, then give her a kiss and life, live the life. We all have a savior. Do yourself a favor. Stop living the life.
Head to abnormalentertainment.com for all of our podcasts and blogs. Go to cinemaheadcheese.com for our movie reviews and news. Don't forget our YouTube channels, Abnormal Podcast and Cinema Head Cheese. Get us on Twitter, at Abnormal Podcast, and find all of our shows and Abnormal Entertainment on Facebook. New content 7 days a week from Abnormal Entertainment.
You've been listening to the Abnormal Entertainment Network.